Welcome, everyone. So we have Allison Randal here to talk to us about open source accelerating innovation. Please, could you all give her a warm welcome?
How's the volume? Can you hear me in the back? Turn it up a bit. How's that? All right. And if it all comes back to being all alone at the starting gate, so be it. We hadn't wanted this fuss, these extras. We were calm under an appearance of turmoil, and so we remain, even today, an unwanted inspiration to those who come immediately after, as well as those who came before, lots of them, stretching back into times of discussion. So I think a lot of us probably know the story of the beginning of free software and open source. There's this man named Richard Stallman who had an encounter with a printer that was not notifying people when it had a paper jam, and so they would try to print things and never find out that it had been sitting there for hours and wasn't printing. So he modified the software so it would send out a notification when there was a paper jam. But then a new version of the printer came out, and the new version of the printer didn't give him the software to modify it to apply the same patch he had already made to keep the printer more useful in the MIT AI lab. I already had an idea that software should be shared, but I wasn't sure how to think about that. After this experience, I started to recognize what the issue was and how big it was. So he wrote this program called Emacs, and he began to talk about Emacs in terms of communal sharing, that when he made edits, he would like other people to share the edits so that the software itself gets shared all around. In the mid-80s, he launched the GNU project, wrote the GNU manifesto, founded the Free Software Foundation, and wrote something called the GNU Emacs license for Emacs, which in the late 80s, he generalized to take out the word Emacs so that it was the GNU general public license. So we talk about the story, but we very rarely talk about the context in which this story happened. And the fundamental question here is, many people think the free software story is a Princess Leia story. They think of it as a rebellion struggling against a vast and entrenched evil empire of proprietary software. It is, in fact, a Princess Queen Amidala story, because it is a story of someone who was living perfectly happy in a sane republic of freely available and modifiable software, with a growing and creeping realization that this was being taken away, that the Republic was dying in the face of an evil empire. See, the thing is, when Stallman first modified that software, there was no such thing as software copyright. In the 70s, software copyright didn't exist. All software could be freely modified and redistributed. So in the United States, software became copyrightable in the 1980s. Various countries followed. The United States was the first. In Australia, it was 1984 that it was added to the Australian Copyright Act. And the curious thing is, even after it was added to the Copyright Act in various different countries, there were still a series of legal cases debating whether software could be subjected to copyright law. Apple Computer was the first in around 1982. So the way I often describe it is you need to understand that free software is an equal and opposite reaction to the start of software copyright. So I have a little bit of analogy that sometimes helps people understand. So when an object makes a sound, the sound travels outward from the source of the noise at a very regular pace. You can almost imagine it like dropping a pebble in a pool of water, and you can see the rings traveling outward. So it's a ripple effect. So this corresponds to the 40s to the 70s. Software started in about the 40s. So there was a slow pattern of innovation. You can see it spreading outward, but software was not valued. Software was considered simply a thing that made the hardware more useful. Many companies listed their software as a $0 asset. They didn't consider it valuable whatsoever. So in a sense, At this point in time, all software was free and open, at least in the sense that it was free to use, modify, redistribute, study, the four freedoms that we expect. You can't have copyleft without copyright, but you could say that in a sense all software was permissive. So when an object, like sound travels in waves, when an object starts to move, well, it starts to catch up with its own sound. So you get this sort of, the sound is still traveling exactly the same pace, the object is traveling closer, like sort of following along behind it. So you get this sort of bunching effect. This corresponds to the 70s. This was sort of like a precursor period. People started talking about the concept of copyright. There's a famous letter from Bill Gates to a computer club telling them that they're stealing his software. But actually, he had no legal grounds to claim that. It was not stealing. It was perfectly legal. So then the next phase, in terms of our analogy, when an object travels at exactly the speed of sound, sound waves are traveling along, the object is traveling at the same speed as the sound waves, so it keeps catching up with its own sound waves, and the sound waves start piling up and piling up and piling up, and it creates this enormous turbulent zone. So this was called the sound barrier. People thought it was unbreakable. Pilots died trying to break the sound barrier. They didn't think it could be done. So this corresponds to the 80s. This is when software copyright was launched. And this is the beginning of things like Windows and Mac and Oracle. But at the same time, there was a growing body of free and open source software. This is when free software was created. This is when the GNU project was started. And BSD had been going since the 70s and was continuing right through the 80s. So it's not like it stopped with the creation of proprietary software. It just kept growing. There's a couple of concepts here that are important. Innovation and commoditization. Innovation is sort of that leading edge of software growing, the new things, the new ideas, and commoditization is the trailing edge. As a new idea gets launched, it's unique, it's fantastic, and then it becomes more common, and then everybody has it, and then nobody's willing to pay money for it because, like, it's so common that it would be like paying for dirt. So the question in the 80s was who leads? There was this concept that proprietary software was the leader of innovation and always would be. It was this enormous boon to software innovation. But they kind of forgot to notice that this body of free and open source software kept growing. It kept growing and growing and growing. But there was a concept that it would always be falling behind, that free and open source would always be chasing after Windows, trying to catch up with Windows. So you start, object is catching up with the sound waves, and then it catches up with the sound waves, and then what happens? When the object starts going faster than the sound waves, a funny thing happens. Instead of now running against that like massive turbulent zone, it just zips right past it, and the sound waves start falling along behind. And it's no longer a problem. See, it turns out there is no such thing as the sound barrier. It does not exist. It's a convergence of transition effects between traveling at below the speed of sound and above the speed of sound. So you only get it in that tiny little band when you're traveling exactly at the speed of sound. Here's the secret. There is no such thing as a proprietary edge. That concept that they had in the 80s, that proprietary software would be leading the way forever, was a total myth. So there are a bunch of different factors. You can't pin it down exactly, but this period, this traveling, sort of crossing past the sound barrier in the analogy, it corresponds approximately to the year 2000. Not exactly, but approximately. So there's some factors in there. One of them is corporate adoption. So there had been an enormous body of free and open source software growing for decades, but that point is about when we started to see big companies noticing and starting to use it. and starting to really see it as a significant piece of their business. That's also the time that a handful of people came up with the idea of calling it open source, not to make it something different, but just they wanted to, in a sense, market the concept of free software to the companies who were beginning to adopt it. It's the time of the dot-com bubble. So suddenly, all these companies that had been like well-funded with plushy Aeron chairs could no longer afford to pay for like Oracle database licenses to run their pet food store. Like, it just wasn't a reasonable expense anymore. And suddenly, all this free and open source software that had become so common, like Apache and MySQL, became really, really attractive because it was free. And at that point, quite stable. Web 2.0 was powered by free and open source software. So there's a fundamental piece here of economic necessity. And that is, once all of your competitors start using open source software, then if you decide, well, I'm going to write my own database from scratch, or I'm going to pay that massive expensive database license, you're actually at a disadvantage to all of your competitors. There's a funny fact here that in retrospect seems obvious, which is, if you take your knowledge and you lock it away in a box, it's actually a barrier to anyone innovating on that knowledge. Because if they never have access to it, they're gonna have to reinvent them themselves, and it's gonna take them far, far longer. And if you have a whole bunch of little black boxes of knowledge locked up all over the place, then it slows down innovation across an entire industry. There are some advantages that people found around the year 2000. It was there before, but they started really talking about it then, around the collaborative process, that if you get a whole bunch of brains together, they can do better work, they can see more bugs. And these are true. It's not a silver bullet, and that is something that's been found in the subsequent decades. Just saying we have a collaborative process and we have an open source license does not automatically mean your software is better. It's a better chance. It's a chance at doing better because you have the potential to benefit from collaborative effects and more eyes. And oftentimes it is, in fact, the human factors of collaboration that get in the way of open source projects as much as they do benefit open source projects. But the really fundamental shift here in this like era of software, when we get past the sound barrier, is that open source and free software, instead of being the trailing edge, became the leading edge of quite a few things, like Web 2.0 and the internet and very fundamental pieces of technology of the time. They were led by open source rather than following behind. So there's a well-known concept in development, human development around the world, and that is the idea that freedom powers progress. This is not just in technology. In the sense of, like, many of the advantages that we enjoy in our modern society that you cannot find in a society that's struggling with lack of freedom is very much because we have those freedoms. They provide a platform for the progress. So, different countries have different definitions of freedom. To be a little bit more generic, I'll take a step back and use the United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is very similar to many individual countries' definitions. This was established in 1948 in the wake of a really terrible, horrible, destructive war. So we have things like freedom of speech and belief, freedom from fear and want, right to life, liberty, and security of person. Freedom of privacy, phrased very poorly, but it was 1948. freedom of movement and residence. Freedom of thought, conscience, and religion. Freedom of opinion and expression. Freedom of peaceful assembly and association. So this is just a few highlights out of a fairly lengthy document. In many ways, these are common sense. So if you think about, if someone is spending all of their mental bandwidth wondering where their next meal is going to come from, or wondering if they're going to have their head bashed in by the barbarian hordes, They don't have a lot of mental capacity left over to think about how to build a better hoe, or how to do more efficient farming, or how to build a smartphone. It's just freedom is an essential baseline for even getting to the point that you have time in your society to make progress. So what are the essential freedoms? There's one model of defining this that the UN has used to actually rate societies around the world, almost like a checklist of freedoms. And this is known as the capabilities approach. You'll see many of those freedoms I just mentioned included. One of the things, perspectives that they have that's especially important is permission is not enough. So if you have, say, freedom of education, but you're actually not given any way to get that education because it costs too much, or it's like located so far away you couldn't get there if you tried, or you know, if you don't have the capability to exercise that freedom, you don't really have that freedom. So you have to have both aspects, the permission and the capability. Now, one of the freedoms within this definition, the capabilities approach, is control over one's material environment. Now, if you imagine living in a room where you're not allowed to put posters on the wall or move anything around or change anything, you're not really free in that room. You know, you're in a sense, you're confined or imprisoned because you don't have the freedom to modify it. So a funny thing has happened since the 40s when software was a domain of a very small group of experts. Software today is pretty much everywhere. And the users of software are pretty much everyone. Even in the remotest parts of Africa, where you would think they have absolutely no access to technology whatsoever, you will very commonly see them with very stupid phones that are just simply text-based, but that's contacting their bank. And that bank is controlling their money, and that bank is running software, and their lives are touched by that software. So, the connection here is that, in a very real sense, software freedom is about control over our material environment. Like, this phone is a whole lot more than just like an object that sits on the side. This phone is my window into a large part of the universe. And if I don't control it, I don't control my material environment. In the same way, if I live in a room that I can't change, I don't have freedom. So there's an important caveat here. So there's a philosophical concept of necessary and sufficient. If I'm hungry and I want to be full, a necessary condition for becoming full is I have to eat something. If I don't eat something, I will never become full. It's just a necessary condition. But if I eat a potato chip, it's probably not going to make me full. So like, yes, I ate something, but it wasn't sufficient to actually make me full. So the thing about software freedom is it is a necessary freedom to have a free society, but it's not sufficient in and of itself. If you have software freedom, but you don't have the freedom of speech, you don't have the freedom of privacy, you don't have all the other freedoms, you don't really have a free society. So it's important to keep in mind that software freedom is a necessary condition for a free society, but it's not a sufficient condition all on its own. So that's the past. So what happens when an object then keeps accelerating is those sound waves just sort of fall farther and farther behind, and that disruptive zone just gets thinner and thinner and thinner, and it's less and less disruptive. And this is what's happened to open source. So since the 2000s, to the 2010s. In 2010, there was a survey that was repeated in 2015, and it showed corporations reporting in 2010 a 42% use of open source software, in 2015 a 78% use of open source software, and in 2015 also 64% reported that they were like collaborating, participating in open source projects. So once something like open source becomes ubiquitous, once everyone is using it, then it becomes simply, using it becomes table stakes just to get into the game. If you're not smart enough to use it, you're out cold from the beginning. But then where's your competitive edge? If using it is just table stakes. So then the competitive edge becomes participation. So the companies that participate in open source, they get their bugs fixed faster, they get their features added faster, they get their needs met more quickly than the companies that don't, and that's a competitive edge. So this has an interesting compounding effect. So the more companies pour money into open source, pour resources into open source, the more they accelerate the pattern of innovation because they're driving the software towards more rapid progress. But then there's a snowball effect, right? Because if they put in more resources, then the software becomes better, and then it becomes, there becomes more and more and more stable and reliable free software and open source. Then that pushes the demand to use it because there's more and more contexts in which open source is the best solution. And because it pushes them to use it, then that becomes table stakes to use that, and then that pushes them to participate more and more and more. So it kind of goes around and around in this circle of escalation. And this is where I bring in the unwanted inspiration, because I can pretty much guarantee that Richard Stallman never had in mind that he was going to inspire a boom of technology progress. That wasn't what he cared about, but he did, because freedom powers progress. And I can also pretty much guarantee that Apple and Microsoft never wanted to be inspired by this band of rebels who told them they were doing the wrong thing, but they do all now participate and release free and open source software. They still have a ways to go, but the world has changed over these decades. And where are we going now? Many people assume wrongly that a company exists simply to make money. While this is an important result of a company's existence, we have to go deeper and find the real reasons for our being. As we investigate this, we inevitably come to the conclusion that a group of people get together and exist as an institution that we call a company, so they are able to accomplish something collectively which they could not accomplish separately. They are able to do something worthwhile. They make a contribution to society. And I would especially look at the year on this quote, 1960. So Tim O'Reilly, who was sort of behind some of the previous strange waves of open source and Web 2.0. His current thing is the next economy. So he has been analyzing companies like Uber and Airbnb that have had a disruptive effect on industries to kind of pick apart why. And some of the things he does is he's observed is that they don't just deliver the same old experience. They don't just deliver the same old thing in a new package. They really kind of take a step ahead to change the way humans experience some aspect of our lives. They don't replace human beings. They make human beings more productive, more powerful, more able to accomplish more things that they couldn't do before. They set out to solve hard problems, not just to like drop whatever somebody else is willing to pay for again. They really do tackle difficult areas. And instead of just assuming that the current industry and economy is the way it will always be, they aren't afraid to rethink it and think outside the box and come up with new ways to improve it. See, in a lot of ways, this is just business 101, right? So if you want customers to pay you, you have to deliver value to them, and you can't just deliver the same value as the last guy. You have to keep delivering more and better value. And what's the value of a software license? Actually, not much. I mean, have you ever seen anybody come up to you and say, ooh, I just got this really shiny software license. This is great. No, they care about what the software does for them. They care about how it makes their lives easier, how it allows them to get their work done, how it allows them to like enjoy themselves. They care about the effect of it, but you could license it in any way, shape, or form. They don't care. And that is a lot of what's sort of the modern trends in open source, or people realizing you could really license this any way you want. That's not what matters. It's the customer experience at the end of the day that matters. Twitter could release their entire platform as open source tomorrow. It wouldn't affect their business whatsoever because their value is the brand name and the networks of friends that people have. And if somebody else launched a clone of Twitter, it wouldn't have that and so it still wouldn't change their business. Wait till the end. So there's one piece of this, and that is the concept of businesses making a contribution to society. There's another piece of this, and that is businesses accomplishing something collectively. Now, there are other ways to accomplish things collectively. Governments accomplish things collectively. And over the decades, we have certainly proven that communities of individuals, whether they have a foundation or not, can accomplish things collectively. So there's been a lot of talk over the past year or so about sustainability, which I think is an important conversation. And having that conversation has pushed the dial a bit. The short version of it is, if you cut down all the trees in the forest and you keep cutting and cutting and never plant new ones, eventually there won't be any trees left. So if you keep taking the software and taking it and taking it and you're never contributing to the open source software, how is it going to keep going? How is it going to continue to be sustainable in the long term in the future? But there's something that worries me about that conversation, and this is that the areas that companies are going to be willing to fund are areas that have commercial value. So these are, say, they run their business on the internet and they need to keep the infrastructure of the internet going, which is great. We really need them to contribute to that. Or it has commercial value because they distribute it to customers. But there is so much in the world that is not about commercial value that I worry if we overemphasize what can be funded because of its commercial value, we miss so much. Rufus Pollack has been writing a lot lately. He's the founder of the Open Knowledge Foundation, about the difficulties in funding technology that has civic value, that has more humanitarian value. And you know, a government might be willing to fund education software, it might be willing to fund software that's sort of public interest, but how many governments do you know are really excited about funding technology about governmental transparency? So it's like there's these range of things that, like, the institutions that we have aren't necessarily the ones to fund the chain, this realm of software. There is a realm of software that falls outside of the funding channels we typically think of. So I think as we look into the future, it's also important to think about, and this is why I loved Pia's talk, it's also important to think about software that improves education and healthcare and agriculture, that helps us avoid destroying our environment, that helps balance some of the entirely unjust economic inequalities that exist in our world. Software that creates opportunities for human beings. So there's a contribution to society that companies can make, and they should, and we encourage it, but there's also a contribution to society that all of us need to make, and it's a lot bigger than what we've seen so far in open source. Innovation is so much bigger than the tech industry. Innovation has been going on as long as humans have had enough sentience to think about the environment they live in and improve it. And I think it's important to remember that ultimately the focus of free software and open source is a free society. It's about a fundamental software freedom, but fundamental software freedom by itself is not enough. So I meant to give this talk for the first time last year. I broke my foot, I couldn't come, so now I'm giving it for the last time. My talk last year, the last time here, but that's given me a lot of time to evolve the talk, but also have a lot of conversations with people sort of around the talk. And I started with a question, in a sense. So open source as a term, it was launched for the purpose of encouraging corporate adoption. So that's why it was created as a distinction from free software. But around 2010, people started saying, open source is one, we have corporate adoption. And it's been annoying me because I can see that we have not won. I mean, yes, we won, or we partly won in that space, and there's still room to grow, but we're doing very well in that space. But that doesn't mean we won, it just means, you know, we crested one mountain on the way up, you know, we're sort of into the foothills, which is great, but we still have a long way to go. And I'm pretty well convinced that at this point, that this is the next phase. It's the software is more than just technology industry. Software is for improving the future of humanity, which Pia echoed brilliantly, and I think we must have been in telepathic communication or something. So there are a bunch of different pieces that we're going to need along this way. And like, I'm not talking about this as a next year goal. This is like 50 years. This is 100 years. We talk about diversity, and I think so. There are many different dimensions to diversity. There's gender identity, there's race, there's culture, there's geography. But there's also things like a diversity of skills, a diversity of perspectives and ideas. And you know, part of where we're stuck right now is we kind of have this idea of what open source should be, or this idea of what software should be, or what the tech industry should be. And getting that diversity of perspectives is how we push past that plateau and start climbing the next level. So myopic monocultures actually have a weakness because they miss the dangers they don't know to look for. And the strength of diversity is that people see more problems and they see more solutions. And that's why we need it. So if you only take one thing away, I want you to leave knowing that you are empowered to change the world for the better. You have my permission. But I know that permission is not enough. So if you don't feel like you have the capability to make the world a better place, I want you to look around you, because these people around you have skills, and when we share our skills and pool our skills, it makes more and more people empowered to help make the world a better place and to make software more than just an economic necessity, more than just corporate adoption, and really change the world. I told you so. We can handle it. Hand on the stick shift, headed into the billboard labeled tomorrow. The adventures of new music, Melissima's shrouding the past and the passing days. Thank you.
Question time. Okay, we've got one over here.
Firstly, I'm just going to fangirl you. Love your work. That's awesome. Thank you. But the question is, some of the systems that are problematic are around that question of sustainability, because when you have an assumption of continual growth as itself a KPI for particularly publicly listed companies. So I totally agree. Company, and I've had the conversation on Twitter as well, as just an organization of people. I'm asking a quick question. The quick question is, how do we overcome the fact that systemically continual growth gets in the way of sustainability as itself a goal?
That's a hard one. The way I see it is, in a sense, we're not going to change the economic model of companies trying to grow and grow and grow and grow, but we need to recognize that's a separate thing, and that's not enough, and there need to be other systems. And when there are other systems over time, they can overtake this. Like this may be an evolutionarily poor model, and if so, we can get to the point that they dwindle off and die. But we have to have the alternative models first, and I'm not sure we really do yet, although there's some experiments, but yeah.
Regarding your comment about Twitter open sourcing, how much do you think would that change if the Twitter protocol were or became federated? Or differently put, how can we have decentralized federated staff and still make money and pay our rent and fee our mouths?
Well, so you're assuming a model. It's actually, Twitter's a poor example because they don't really make money off of their software anyway. But
let's just assume they do.
Right. So the key thing about business models that don't rely on software licensing is you have to realize that the customers are paying for different things. So if you are in a decentralized data Twitter system, I'm just going to make up, say there is a decentralized Twitter, and you do have people who want to make money. Not everybody's going to want to run their own server. So then you end up with a decentralized set of servers that people can pay for. And then you end up with a free market economy of they'll go to one or the other because they prefer the service, because they got it was easier to use, they found it easier to find their friends, like whatever. There are various different aspects of it that made it more attractive. The customer service actually answers their question when they have a problem. It ran on faster hardware. There's various different ways that you make things more attractive to customers that aren't about the software. Which means there's plenty of ways to make money that aren't about owning the Twitter brand name and completely locking it down and completely locking down the APIs. You could have a world of completely mobile, well, email. Like anybody can go to another email service and then copy over their old emails and like they're on a new service provider. They do it all the time. It's kind of because it's commoditized now. But plenty of people make money off of selling email services.
It sounds like you're sort of, we've gone from free software to open source software, gotten that win, and you're sort of thinking we should push back towards the more ethical side of it. Like, I don't know, do you see a risk of falling back down the mountain? Like, is this, can we do it wrong?
I do. So there is a perception of open source as being something different than free software, and like somehow to succeed at open source, we had to abandon the principles of free software. So if you read the open source definition, which is almost a straight copy of the Debian Free Software Guidelines, you see that all the philosophical principles of software freedom, of free software, are in the open source definition. And open source never gave up on those principles. So we're not going backwards. In a sense, it's more like realizing the fundamental reason for our success, that it was freedom and not just shiny things like, ooh, participation. And then thinking about, okay, so if it is freedom that is the reason we succeeded, what's the implication for the future? So, I mean, the thing I'm worried about in terms of sliding backward is like the persistent belief that proprietary software is somehow better than free software. I'm worried about digging ourselves deeper and deeper into the hole of ridiculous copyright and patent restrictions, rather than realizing that those systems are fundamentally broken and need to change. So I mean, I think there's a lot of ways we could slide back into holes, but I don't think appreciating and celebrating the advantages of software freedom is a hole at all. I don't think that's a backslide at all.
Any more questions? Anyone down the back? No? Oh, yes, okay.
Twitter is a good example. We're actually, we are moving away from shipping software. A lot of companies are service.
Is this a question or is?
This is a question. Okay. A lot of companies are service companies now. How does that change things? Most companies don't ship software that are tech companies. So what does that mean for all this?
The point that often comes up is our current ideas of how to handle copyleft don't really handle the services model. I think it's an advantage because if you're in a services model, you have less and less reason to care about whether you own the bits of your software or like own them in the sense of proprietary licensing. So I think it can be an advantage, but we have to be conscious about it and make sure that we don't backslide into, ooh, proprietary software is better because our services are secret and we don't really have to release the software. And I think if you lead into that decentralized model, like open source software as a service is one of the best ways to get there. And that has implications for data privacy and like freedom to own your own data and things like that as well.
Okay.
Yeah. So overall, I think moving to a services model is actually good for software freedom.
Okay, any more? No? All right, well, thank you so much for such a wonderful, insightful talk. And on behalf of LCA, we have a little gift to thank you. So yeah, thank you so much for coming.